In our earlier lecture, namely lecture IN1A, we discussed about Euclidean space, and in lecture IN1D, we discussed about handedness of coordinate system. We stated that in physics, we proceed with right-handed coordinate system. In this lecture, we will be continuing with further discussion on coordinate system. Let us begin this lecture by calling to mind a person whose work you came across in your first class of physics, whichever branch you start with. The story of an apple landing straight upon Newton is a famous one. But another story that is equally famous is that of a fly hovering underneath a ceiling of a famous person who had the habit of sleeping till 11 in the morning. It was René Descartes, a French mathematician, who stayed in bed late, and as the hovering fly caught his attention, his thoughts blossomed, and that was the beginning of Cartesian coordinate system. There are some other very interesting stories of his life, and I will come to them in between the topics I discuss today. There are two types of coordinate system. The first one is rectangular coordinate system, and the other one is curvilinear coordinate system. Rectangular coordinate system involves intersection or crossover of two straight lines at 90 degrees, while in case of 3D, three planes will crossover or intersect, and here are the three planes. This is one plane, this is another plane, and this is the third plane. Rectangular coordinate system was conceptualized by René Descartes. Clearly, this coordinate system is orthogonal or rectangular because of the perpendicular intersections. Here it is 90 degrees, and these planes are mutually inclined at 90 degrees. Another coordinate system is curvilinear coordinate system, in which two curves can intersect or three surfaces can intersect. The idea of curvilinear coordinate system was given by Lamé, a French mathematician. Curvilinear coordinate system can be of two types. One is orthogonal, one is non-orthogonal. Let us take up the 2D case, where we consider intersection of two curves, curve 1 and curve 2. And the equation of the curves are, for curve 1 it is u1 is constant, and for curve 2 it is u2 is constant. This can be compared to the rectangular 2D system, where we have an x-axis whose equation is y equal to 0 or some constant, and a y-axis whose equation is x equal to 0 or some constant. Let us draw tangents to them. This is the tangent to curve 1 and this is the tangent to curve 2. If these tangents are perpendicular, we say that we have a 2D curvilinear coordinate system which is orthogonal. And if this angle is not 90 degrees, then we have a non-orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in 2D. Let us next consider the 3D situation, where we consider intersection of three surfaces, and the intersection occurs along three curved lines which are denoted by U1 curve, U2 curve and U3 curve. This is analogous to the rectangular system, where we have an x-axis or x-line, y-axis or y-line, and z-axis or z-line. The surfaces that intersect along these curves are defined or described by the equations u1 equal to c1, which is a constant for this surface, u2 equal to c2 for this surface, and u3 equal to c3, which is some constant for this surface. This is analogous to the rectangular system where we have an xy plane whose equation is z is equal to 0 or some constant, yz plane whose equation is x equal to 0 or some constant, and xz plane whose equation is y equal to 0 or some constant. Now let us draw tangents to these curved lines or edges, and they are u1 cap or u1 hat, which is tangent to u1 curve, e2 cap or e2 hat, which is the tangent to the u2 curve, and e3 cap or e3 hat, which is the tangent to the u3 curve. Now if u1 cap, e2 cap and e3 cap, these tangential unit vectors are perpendicular or orthogonal to each other, then we say that we have an orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in 3D. And if not, we have a non-orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in 3D. Let me make a list of analogous relations. This is for 2D and this is for 3D. We will discuss the following coordinate systems: rectangular, 2D and 3D Cartesian coordinate system. We will be discussing orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in 2D and 3D. In 2D we have plane polar coordinate system, and in 3D we have spherical polar coordinate system and cylindrical polar coordinate system. We would also be discussing general orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in 3D. There are some other coordinate systems which we will try to discuss. For instance, the elliptic coordinate system, which is used for solving Laplace equation and Helmholtz equation. The parabolic coordinate system, which is used to describe Stark effect. We'll bring into discussion the geographic coordinate system, which is used to determine locations on Earth, as well as celestial coordinate system, which is used to specify positions of satellite, planet, stars and galaxies, that is position of heavenly bodies. In this lecture, we'll be concerned with rectangular Cartesian coordinate system in 2D and 3D, as well as the plane polar coordinates. We'll discuss the other coordinate systems in the coming lectures. We come to two-dimensional rectangular Cartesian coordinate system built by orthogonal crossover of two real number lines, the x-axis and the y-axis. The crossover point is the origin, which is the reference point, and so we can ascribe coordinates to it as x equal to 0 and y equal to 0. Any other point P in 2D will have coordinate x, y. This distance from y-axis is called the x-coordinate, and this distance from the x-axis is called the y-coordinate. And xy is an ordered pair. We cannot write it in any manner. This is the convention which we are to follow, and it represents the position of a particle. Unit vector along x-axis is i-cap. And unit vector along y-axis is j-cap. X-line and y-line divide this entire 2D plane into four quadrants: first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant and the fourth quadrant. We next move to 3D rectangular Cartesian coordinate system, and these are alternate drawings. It is built by the orthogonal crossover of three real number lines, the x-axis, the y-axis and the z-axis. The x-axis, the y-axis and the z-axis. The crossover point is called the origin, which has coordinates x equal to 0, y equal to 0 and z is equal to 0. Any other point P in 3D will have coordinate x, y, z. if we drop a perpendicular from P on the x-axis, then the foot of the perpendicular is at a distance x from the origin, and so its coordinate is x 0 0. And similarly, if we drop perpendicular from P onto y-axis, then the foot of the perpendicular is at a distance y from the origin, and so the coordinate of this point is 0, y 0. If we drop a perpendicular from P onto the z-axis, then the foot of the perpendicular is at a distance z from the origin, and the coordinate of this point is 0, 0, z. The x-line, the y-line, and the z-line divides the entire space into 8 octets, and let us demonstrate that. X and y-axis divides the 2D into 4 quadrants. This is the first quadrant, second quadrant, third quadrant, fourth quadrant. If we attach the z-axis to this 2D plane, then the 3D space is divided into 8 parts. Each part is called an octet, and here it is. This is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this one is the z-axis. This is the first octet, this is the second octet, the third octet, the fourth octet, the fifth octet, the sixth octet, the seventh octet, eighth octet. Clearly, the entire space is divided into 8 equal parts called octets. If we drop a perpendicular from point P onto the xy plane, then Q is the foot of the perpendicular, which obviously lies in the xy plane, and its z coordinate is 0. It is at a distance x from the y axis, so this distance is x. It is at a distance y from the x-axis, so this distance is y, and it has therefore the coordinates x, y, and 0. The unit vectors are x-cap or i-cap along x-axis, y-cap or j-cap along y-axis, and z-cap or k-cap along z-axis. As we can move indefinitely along positive x-axis as well as along negative x-axis, it follows that the limits of x will be minus infinity to plus infinity, and similarly for the limits on y and z, because we can move indefinitely along y-axis in both positive as well as negative directions. Along z also, we can move along positive z as far as we please, in the positive sense as well as in the negative sense. So these are the limits. Let us now come to a very useful and important topic of orthonormalization. Consider 2D Cartesian coordinate system. This is x-axis and this is y-axis. The unit vectors being i-cap, also denoted by x-cap or u1-cap. And this is y-axis, the unit vector along which is j cap, and also denoted by y cap or e2 cap. Now, use of u1 cap and e2 cap symbols will help us in writing formula or relation in an elegant and abbreviated form. Now, in vector calculus, we shall discuss about dot product, which is a dot b given by ab cos theta, theta being the included angle, from which it follows that dot product between two perpendicular vectors is 0, because the included angle is 90 and theta is 90 and cos 90 is 0. And also the dot product with itself is magnitude square, which is called norm square. And if we take dot product of a unit vector with itself, we get 1. So a cap is of unit norm or unit length, and that is why we call them unit vectors. Now details will be done in vector calculus. So taking dot product of x cap, that is u1 cap, with itself gives u1 cap dot u1 cap is equal to 1. And similarly, dot product of y cap or e2 cap with itself gives unity. And again, dot product of x cap and y cap, that is e1 cap and e2 cap, gives us 0 because they are perpendicular. So we have four relations, and these four relations can be written in this form using Kronecker delta, which we introduced in lecture IN1A. For 3D rectangular coordinate system, we can extend this result. Now here the dummy indices I and j takes values 1 and 2. We can extend this result for 3-dimensional rectangular coordinate system, and then we have to consider I and j to take values 1, 2, 3. Because we are adding z axis, the unit vector along which is k cap, which is also denoted by z cap or e3 cap. And therefore we have the same relation here, only that I and j are 1, 2, 3 instead of 1, 2 in this case, in 2D case. So the orthonormalized relation is ei cap dot ej cap is Kronecker delta ij, where I runs from 1, 2, 3, j runs from 1, 2, 3 in 3D, and I is 1 and 2 and j is 1 and 2 for 2D. Orthonormalized means two properties. First is they are orthogonal. That is, I cap, j cap and k cap are mutually perpendicular to each other, as evident from this set of relations in 3D and these two relations in 2D. Orthonormalization relation also indicates another property, that the unit vectors are normalized. That is, they have unit norm, that is, they have unit length, as evident from this set of relations in 3D and the first and the last relation in case of 2D, because dot product with itself gives 1. Dot product between orthogonal vectors is 0. Being orthogonal plus normalized means the unit vectors are orthonormalized. Another very important terminology that is used is of basis vectors. The unit vectors x cap and y cap in 2D and x cap, y cap, z cap in 3D are referred to as basis vectors, and we say that the basis vectors are orthonormalized. That is, they are orthogonal, they are mutually perpendicular to each other, as well as their length is unity. They are normalized, they are of unit length. So basis vectors are orthonormalized. We shall now go deeper into the coordinate systems. We'll first introduce curvilinear system in 2D. But before that, let me give example of a few formula or expressions which you will come across in your study of different branches of physics that do not depend upon a particular coordinate system. And these formula or expressions are called coordinate free formula. I shall simply show the formula and state in which branch you'd come across them, and will not go into details. In fact, it is a common sense and a very natural expectation for all of us that the laws, the physical laws that govern us or everything, should not depend upon the coordinate system we choose. For instance, while I am talking, I am being pulled by the earth to its center, and I definitely can expect the listener, that is you, who are trying to figure out what I am saying, is also being pulled by the earth towards its center. So the law of earth's pull does not depend upon where you are, that is, your or my coordinates. and the amount of pull is determined by a specific formula. It is inversely proportional to the square of distance between us and the center. It does not depend upon whether you write r or under root the sum of squares, where xi, yi, zi are the coordinates of this point on the surface of Earth and these are the coordinates of the center. This invariance of physical laws under different coordinate systems is called principle of general covariance. Let us make it clear that coordinates are not laws of nature, but are artifices or tricks to describe nature. We mentioned some formula or expressions that has no reference to any particular coordinate system. For instance, the expression of divergence, and you'd come across this one in vector calculus. The expression of curl, actually component of curl along a particular direction. Also, it involves no particular coordinates. You'd come across it in vector calculus. Electric field due to an electric dipole, vector P, at a distance, vector R, which is given by this formula. So this is the dipole arbitrarily placed, and this is the field point at a distance, vector R, from the dipole. Here, in this expression, no reference has been made to the coordinate system. But if we choose a particular coordinate system to analyze the electric field due to a dipole, then the expressions will contain coordinates. For instance, if we orient our z-axis along the dipole, so dipole is now placed along z-axis, so this angle, that is the angle between the radial direction and the dipole axis, which is the z-axis, is theta. Then we have the electric field, which contains r and theta, which are spherical polar coordinates. But if we orient our x-axis along the dipole, then the story is different, because now of electric field due to a dipole is this one, which involves the coordinates x and y. These we will do in electrostatics. Again, if we have a arbitrarily placed magnetic dipole, then the field, the magnetic induction due to this magnetic dipole at a point P will be given by this formula, which is coordinate free, which is analogous to this form, which is also coordinate free. It was due to an electric dipole, and this one is due to a magnetic dipole. But if we orient our z-axis along the magnetic dipole, then this angle becomes theta, and this is the radial direction. And in that situation, the magnetic induction at P due to this magnetic dipole will be given by this expression, which we will do in magnetostatics. Cartesian coordinate system in 2D and 3D have been discussed already. And one is not mistaken if one thinks that we can solve every problem in the universe with this coordinate system, that is x, y, z. Theoretically we can do it, but terrible complication might arise. And mathematics is a story of simplification. For instance, consider a particle moving in a circle or a sphere or a cylinder. Now circle, sphere or cylinder are symmetric objects, and we can achieve immense simplification if we use a different coordinate system. Use of Cartesian coordinates x, y, z for these systems will definitely solve the problem, but it would be lengthy and complicated. Mathematical operations such as taking gradient, divergence, curl, etc. will also be involved and time consuming. and we'll elaborate this later. So in 2D, we will use plane polar coordinate system. And in the next lecture, we'll discuss spherical polar coordinate system and cylindrical polar coordinate system. In a nutshell, we wish to move beyond the Cartesian coordinate system, the coordinate system which René Descartes discovered. Now, before going to it, let me describe the awesome quotation for which René Descartes is famous. And you may find his thoughts a bit weird, but if you spend time on it, you can decipher an ocean in hiding. It is also called Cartesian doubt, which let me brief as follows. The primary mode of knowledge is through our five basic senses: touch, sight, hearing, smell, and taste. And sensory experiences are often erroneous. There may be hallucinations or other unreal hidden feelings. So once Descartes doubted about his own existence, that is, doubt appeared in his mind whether he existed or not. And after severe logical arguments and analysis, Descartes finally arrived at a conclusion at the end of frantic search to find himself. He found that since it was he himself doubting his own existence, it cannot be true. He ruled the benefit of doubt in his favor, and as he came to the valuable conclusion that he existed, that he indeed existed, he cried out, "Cogito ergo sum," in Latin, the English version of which is, "I think, therefore I am." A number of serious discourses, logic, reasoning follows from here in a mind that knows the philosophy of existence. But I prefer not to go into that, and let us be more concerned with the plane polar coordinate system. This is the plane polar coordinate system. This is the origin, also called the pole, and this is x-axis, this is y-axis. Any point P has Cartesian coordinate xy. Now in this plane polar system, which is 2D, the distance of the point from the pole or the origin is rho. An angular separation of this line from the x-axis is phi. So the angle phi is measured from x-axis, which is also called the polar axis, and the measurement should be in the anti-clockwise sense as per convention. One thing is to be clearly noted: we are using here rho phi, but there are many people who use r for rho and theta for phi. But we'll stick to this symbol rho phi in this lecture. It is clear that if we draw a circle of radius rho with center at the pole or origin, then every point on the circle will have the same rho, because rho then represents radius of the circle. But the points on the circle will have varying phi. It is very important to note that Cartesian coordinate xy is equivalent to the plane polar coordinate rho phi. None carries any extra or additional information. They have the same status. We can use whichever we want. Now, as rho represents radius of a circle, it cannot be negative. And at the pole, rho is zero. And we can go any far along this line, which is the direction of rho. So the range of rho is 0 to infinity. On x-axis, the value of phi is 0, because phi is measured from x-axis. but we can start from x-axis, make a full rotation and come back to x-axis, and then the value of phi is 2 pi. This means the range of phi is 0 to 2 pi, and it is to be noted that phi equal to 0 and phi equal to 2 pi or 4 pi or 6 pi are the same point, provided rho is same. Let us define rho cap and phi cap. If we move radially outwards, we are moving along rho cap, which is the direction of increase of rho. So rho cap is the radial unit vector in 2D, that is in the xy plane, and phi cap is the unit vector in the direction of increase of phi, and you have to move in the anticlockwise sense. Also, as plane polar coordinate system is an orthogonal coordinate system, phi cap will be orthogonal to rho cap. So at P, this is rho cap and this is phi cap. Rho cap is along the radius, phi cap is along the tangent, and obviously this is 90 degrees. We will now compare the unit vectors I cap or X cap and J cap or Y cap of the Cartesian coordinate system with the unit vectors rho cap and phi cap of the plane polar coordinate system. Let us concentrate upon this figure and try to figure out the unit vectors at various points. First, the Cartesian unit vector x hat. X hat is in this direction at the origin, and it is in the same direction at points P, P prime, P double prime, and at any other point. Cartesian unit vector y cap is along this direction at the origin, and so it is at points P, P prime, and P double prime, and at any other point. This means that the Cartesian unit vectors x cap and y cap do not change. They are constant unit vectors. They are similarly directed at all points. Let us now come to the plane polar unit vectors. First, the radial unit vector rho hat. Rho hat is radially outward from the origin, and this is the direction of rho hat at P, and at P prime also rho hat is in the same direction, but at P double prime rho hat is in a different direction. And what about phi hat? Phi hat is perpendicular to rho cap in the anticlockwise sense, as stated earlier. So phi cap is along this direction at P, along this direction at P prime, and along this direction at P double prime. So it follows that the unit vectors rho cap and phi cap are variable. They vary from point to point. Clearly, there is a glaring difference of plane polar unit vectors rho cap and phi cap from the Cartesian unit vectors x cap and y cap. Because rho cap and phi cap are variable unit vectors, they vary from point to point. Let me be more specific. With what do they vary? Now, for different rho, say at points P and P prime, here rho is different, but we find that rho cap is same, phi cap is also same. Now, for different phi, say at points P, where phi is this angle, and at P double prime, where phi is actually phi double prime. So we have two points where phis are different. Now at P, rho cap is along this direction and this is phi cap, but at P double prime, having a different phi, it has phi cap along this direction and rho cap along this direction. So we see that rho cap and phi cap depend upon phi. They change with phi. Let us next mention the advantage of using the plane polar coordinate system. If a particle, say an ant or a bead, move on a circle, the coordinates we need to describe its motion in a disciplined manner, in a systematic fashion, is either through the Cartesian coordinate system xy or through the plane polar coordinate system rho phi. Now it is very easy to understand that if we use the Cartesian coordinate system, we always have to keep track of both x and y as the particle moves over the circle, because x and y both are changing. But if we use the rho phi system, that is plain polar coordinates, then irrespective of the position of the particle, rho is fixed, rho being the radius of the circle, and phi will change. So it is sufficient to keep track of phi only if we use rho phi system. So in other words, if we use the plain polar coordinate system, we have to keep track of only one coordinate. We have to deal with only one phi. But if we use xy, at any time we have to deal with two coordinates. So if there is circular symmetry, use of rho phi simplifies our task and calculation. Let us however add that we can proceed with xy, no problem, but it would be a bit lengthier. Again, if a particle say is moving in this plane and there is no circular symmetry, then we can use either xy or rho phi, with none favoring us more than the other. We will now do some calculations and solve a few problems. We have brought into discussion two sets of coordinates. One is xy and the other is rho phi. So we need to interrelate them, and we'll do so by geometrical means. It is easy. And in the next lecture, we'll connect them in a more disciplined and formal manner using matrix approach. Now here is x-axis, here is y-axis. This is x, this is y, and OP is rho, and this angle AOP is phi, which is measured in the anticlockwise sense from the polar axis, which is this x-axis, O being the pole. We have a parallelogram OAPB, and we can use parallelogram law of vector addition to end up with vector OP is equal to vector OA plus vector OB, and OP is rho rho cap, OA is XX cap and OB is YY cap, and therefore we have this relation. We can use Pythagoras theorem to the triangle OAP, and therefore we get OP square is equal to OA square plus AP square, and this leads to this relation. Again, in this triangle OAP, the value of cosine of phi, which is base OA by hypotenuse OP, is given by x by rho, and therefore we have x equal to rho cos phi. And similarly, sine phi, which is perpendicular by hypotenuse, perpendicular is AP, hypotenuse is OP, that leads us to y equal to rho sine phi. And we can divide one by the other to end up with the value of tan phi being y by x, which gives phi is tan inverse y by x. Now a few problems. We have collected the relations as done previously, and it follows from these relations that if we are given the value of rho and phi, we can easily employ these relations to find the value of x and y. And similarly, if we are given x and y, we can use these relations to end up with the values of rho and phi. So in the first problem, x is 3 and y 4, we have to find the plane polar coordinates. So here is x equal to 3 and y is 4, so we end up with this point. So the Cartesian coordinates are 3 and 4. So using this relation, the values of rho and phi are obtained to be 5 and 53.13 degrees. In the next problem, rho is 4 and phi is 100, so rho is this distance, which is 4, and phi is this angle, which is 100 degrees, and therefore we have this point. The plane polar coordinates are 4 and 100 degrees, and our task is to find the Cartesian coordinates, which we can do using these two relations, and this gives us x as -0.69 and y as 3.94, and this negative sign is connected to the fact that phi is greater than 90 degrees and that cos phi is negative. Everything is apparent in this diagram. Here this is x -0.69 and y is 3.94, just below 4. Now these are two easy problems. Here the Cartesian coordinates are supplied. We have to find the plane polar coordinates. So x is 0, y is 1 means this point. And we can use these relations to get the value of rho to be 1 and phi to be 90 degrees. Again, if x is 1, y is 0, this means we are here. This is x1 and y is 0, and we can use these relations as before to end up with rho as 1 and phi as 0, and phi is 0 on the x-axis. We come to a bit harder problem now. We have to plot the following polar equation, r equal to minus 12 cos theta. This is the first problem, and we have written it, and in our notation r is actually rho and theta is actually phi, so we can change the notation and write it rho equal to minus 12 cos phi and proceed. But here let us maintain r and theta as given in the question. Now multiply by r and we end up with this relation. Again, rho cos phi, which is actually in this problem r cos theta, is x, and therefore, and rho square is x square plus y square. Here rho square is r square, so we have this relation, and some manipulation leads us to this result. Now this is clearly the equation of a circle, and here it is. The circle has center here, whose coordinates are x equal to minus 6 and y equal to 0, and obviously the radius is 6. So we have plotted r equal to minus 12 cos theta. We now go over to the next problem, which is r equal to 4 cos theta. And this in our notation is rho equal to 4 cos phi. But let us maintain this notation. Now multiply by r and we get r square equal to 4 r cos theta, and again as before rho cos phi, or in this situation it is r cos theta, which is x, and simple manipulation gives us this equation, which represents a circle having center at x equal to 2 and y equal to 0, and radius is 2. Now come to the next problem, r cos theta equal to 12. So this is actually rho cos phi equal to 12, and rho cos phi, or in this notation r cos theta, is actually x, so we have x equal to 12. Now x equal to 12 is just a vertical line here, so this is the plot. Now come to the last problem, r sin theta equal to 4. So here it is. So rho cos phi, which is actually r sin theta, is y. So y is 4. This is what is given in the question. And y equal to 4 is in fact a horizontal line here. So this is the polar plot. Let us now come to a very important problem of physics. We have to show the lines of x constant, y constant, as well as rho constant and phi constant. Now x constant, it is easy to draw this line, which is perpendicular to x axis or parallel to y axis, that is vertical to x, is actually x constant line. On the other hand, this line, which is a horizontal line, or rather a line parallel to the x axis or vertical to y axis, is the needed line, y equal to constant. Now rho constant is a circle. This is the radius of amount rho, while phi equal to constant represents this line where the angle is fixed. So this is the phi equal to constant line. In the next lecture, we will discuss distance in 2D, how to compute it or express it. We'll discuss scale factors, orthonormalization relations, time variation of unit vectors. We'll also discuss line element, how to build it, transformation relation between the two sets of coordinates, x, y and rho phi, and rotation matrix, its significance and properties. I end this lecture by mentioning that René Descartes is remembered for establishing a systematic link between Euclidean geometry and algebra. He is known for his works on analytic geometry, linear algebra, complex analysis, and so on. Descartes was the first modern philosopher who tried to understand the world through reason and rationalism. The story goes as follows. Descartes was forced to teach mathematics to the then queen. In the cold and chilly morning at 5 a.m. in her frigid castle, and soon Descartes caught pneumonia and died in 1650. Some say he was assassinated. His skull is still in display in Paris. In 1663, the Pope placed his works on the Index of Prohibited Books. Descartes' philosophy involves his idea that body and mind are really distinct, a thesis called mind-body dualism. He concluded that the mind that thinks is completely different from his body that exists, and hence he cried out, "I think, therefore I am." Thank you.